हेलो, वेलकम बैक टू आवर चैनल क्यूबिट एजुकेशनल सर्विसेज। इन दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू आवर डिस्कशन ऑन प्रॉब्लम्स ऑफ डेफिनेट इंटीग्रल्स। लेट्स गो टू दिस प्रॉब्लम। द वैल्यू ऑफ द इंटीग्रल ई टू द पावर एक्स इन टू ब्रैकेट लॉग ऑफ साइन एक्स प्लस कॉट ऑफ एक्स डी एक्स विथ लिमिट्स ऑन एक्स एस पाई बाय फोर एंड पाई बाय टू एस। वी रिकॉल द फॉलोइंग प्रॉब्लम टाइप which we discussed in the topic indefinite integral, which says integral of e raised to x into bracket f of x plus f dash of x dx is equal to e raised to x into f of x plus c. If we go back to the integrand here, it has e raised to x and in the bracket it has the functions cot of x and log of sin x. Let us quickly find the derivative of log of sin x. By chain rule, this derivative will be 1 upon sin x, which is the derivative of the outer function, that is log, into derivative of the inner function sin of x, so it will be cos of x. And cos upon sin is cot. Therefore, the given integral is of this problem type, with f of x being log of sin x and f dash of x being cot of x. Therefore, the given integral will be equal to e to the power x into log of sin x with limits pi by 4 and pi by 2 equal to. Let us now substitute x as pi by 2, which is the upper limit, which will give us e to the power pi by 2 into log of sin pi by 2. Sin pi by 2 is 1 and log of 1 is 0 minus. Let us now substitute x as pi by 4. The first term will be e to the power pi by 4 into, let's go to the second term now. Sin pi by 4 is 1 upon root 2, so it will be log of 1 upon root 2 equal to e to the power pi by 2 into 0 will be 0, so no need to write it. Now let's go to the second term. E to the power pi by 4, we have this minus sign into. Log of 1 upon root 2 can also be written as log of 2 to the power minus 1 by 2. 1 upon 2 because we are taking the square root, and minus 1 because root 2 is present in the denominator. So this will be equal to e to the power pi by 4 into minus 1 into minus 1 upon 2, which is the power of 2, into log of 2. Here we have used the property of logarithms, which says log of a raised to m is m into log of a. In our case, a is 2 and m is minus 1 upon 2. The last step would be multiplying minus 1 by minus 1 by 2, which will give us 1 by 2, e to the power pi by 4 as it is, and the last term will be log of 2. So the answer is e to the power pi by 4 into log of 2 divided by 2. Let's compare our answer with the options. We have got 1 by 2 into e to the power pi by 4 into log of 2, which is present in option C. Hence, the correct option is C. Let's go to the next question. Area bounded by the lines y equal to x, x equal to minus 1, x equal to 2, and x axis is. We will first draw the figure and show all the lines. In this diagram, the two vertical lines are x equal to minus 1 and x equal to 2 respectively. The inclined line which passes through the origin is the line y equal to x. And the horizontal line here is the x-axis. According to the problem, we are required to find this area. In the first quadrant, we have the area bounded by y equal to x, x equal to 2 and the x-axis. And in the third quadrant, we have the area bounded by the x-axis, the line y equal to x and the line x equal to minus 1. Notice that the required area consists of areas of two right angled triangles. Therefore, we can skip the integration process entirely and use the formula for area of right angled triangle, which is 1 by 2 into the base into height. Let's first focus our attention on the larger right angled triangle. The base of the right angled triangle is 2 units and the height of the triangle is also 2 units. This point being the point of intersection of y equal to x and x equal to 2, the x and y coordinates of this point will be 2, 2, which will also give us the base and the height of the right angled triangle. So area of the larger right angled triangle will be 1 by 2 into base into height, which will be 2 square units. Let's now go to the smaller triangle. This point in the third quadrant has the coordinates minus 1, minus 1, as it is the point of intersection of the line x equal to minus 1 and the line y equal to x. So clearly, the base of the right angled triangle here will be 1 and the height will also be 1. Therefore, area of the smaller right angled triangle will be half base into height, which will be half square units. And therefore, the required area will be the addition of 2 and 1 upon 2, which is 5 by 2 square units. And that is option A. There are two things which you should note before you solve this problem on your own. First thing is the figure. You should draw the vertical lines x equal to minus 1 and x equal to 2 as well as the inclined line y equal to x correctly. If you are familiar with drawing the lines and the linear inequalities in LPP, then this should not be a very big task for you. Second thing is to realize that there is no need of integration here. Although you are expected to solve this problem by using the fact that definite integral also gives you area under the curve, it is going to take you a lot of time because the smaller area here lies below the x-axis, which will give you the negative value as all points here have negative y coordinates. Therefore, when you solve this problem by using the definite integration, you are required to split your interval of integration at the origin. The first area is going to be minus 1 to 0 x dx, and you are going to take mod of that area because the answer to this definite integral will be negative, plus integral from 0 to 2 x dx. Now, how did x come? X comes from the equation of the blue line, that is y, which is x. However, evaluating the definite integral first, changing its sign, evaluating another definite integral, then substituting the limits is much more difficult and more importantly time consuming than these two simple calculations. So according to me, you can solve this problem quickly by using the formula for area of a right angled triangle. Next question. The value of the definite integral of x into sine cube of x with respect to x, which limits 0 and pi is. To solve this problem, we are going to make use of the following property. Integral of f of x from 0 to a is equal to integral of f of a minus x from 0 to a. Therefore, the given integral, let's call it I, will be equal to 0 to pi, pi minus x into sine cube of pi minus x dx, which is equal to 0 to pi, pi into sine cube pi minus x dx minus 0 to pi x into sine cube of pi minus x dx. We recall the following property of allied angles, which says sine of pi minus theta is sine theta. Using this property, we can say that the second integral will be integral 0 to pi x into sine cube x dx, and that is nothing but the original integral I. So I is equal to 0 to pi pi into sine cube x dx. Therefore, 2i is equal to pi into 0 to pi sine cube x dx. We are now going to use the triple angle formula for sine 3x, which says sine 3 theta is equal to 3 sine theta minus 4 sine cube theta. Therefore, sine cube theta will be equal to 3 sine theta minus sine 3 theta divided by 4. Let us now replace theta by x, and therefore our integrand will be 3 sin x minus sin 3x upon 4. Therefore, I will be equal to, let us shift 2 here, 2 into 4 will be 8, so pi by 8 into. The first term here is 3 sin x, whose integral will be minus 3 cos of x minus. The second term here is sin 3x, whose integral will be minus cos of 3x upon 3. Limits are 0 and pi, equal to pi by 8 into. Let us first substitute x as pi. First term will be cos of pi, which is minus 1. Minus 1 into minus 3 will be 3, plus cos of 3 pi is again minus 1. So the second term will be minus 1 upon 3 minus. Let us now substitute x at 0. Cos 0 is 1. So the first term will be minus 3 plus cos 0 is 1. Second term will be 1 upon 3. Equal to pi by 8 into. First term is 3 minus 1 upon 3, which will be 8 upon 3 minus. Let's go to the second term now, which will be minus 8 upon 3. So effectively we are getting pi by 8 into bracket 8 upon 3 minus minus 8 upon 3, which is 8 upon 3 plus 8 upon 3, which is 16 upon 3, which will be equal to 2 pi by 3. So our answer is 2 pi by 3. Let's now go back to the problem. 2 pi by 3 is option B. To conclude this, let us go through the solution one more time. First thing to be noted is that we made use of this particular property of definite integrals. Second thing, we used this particular property of allied angles to simplify the term sine cube of pi minus x. Third thing, to evaluate the integral of sine cube x dx, we used the triple angle formula of sine 3 theta. And in the last steps, we just continued simplifying the integral, which gave us the answer as 2 pi by 3. Next question. The area bounded between the curve x squared equal to y and the line y equal to 4x is. We are given two curves. One of them is y equal to x squared, which is a parabola. The second curve is the straight line y equal to 4x. As this equation does not contain any constant term, this line passes through origin. Let us now try to trace the parabola y equal to x squared as well as the line y equal to 4x. Let this be the x-axis. Let this be the y-axis. We know that the parabola y equal to x squared is symmetric about the y-axis as it contains even powers of x. So, it will be something like this. Y equal to x squared. Let us now go and plot the line y equal to 4x. As already pointed out, this line passes through origin. Secondly, the slope of the line is positive, which means it makes an acute angle with the x-axis. So we can show it here like this. Y equal to 4x. Having completed the figure, now we will show the required area, which will be this particular area in the yellow color, which is bounded by the straight line y equal to 4x above and by the parabola y equal to x squared below. Let's now find out the coordinates of this particular point where the parabola and the straight line intersect. We can do it by solving the equations y equal to x squared and y equal to 4x simultaneously. Therefore, x squared equal to y equal to 4x, which gives us x squared equal to 4x. If you solve this quadratic equation, you will get two roots, x equal to 0 and x equal to 4. We have already considered x equal to 0 because origin is the second point of intersection. And if x is equal to 4, the y coordinate will be 4x, which is 16. So this point is 4, 16. If we now drop a perpendicular from the point 4, 16 to the x-axis, this point will have coordinates 4, 0. To find the required area, we proceed as follows. We first find out area of the right angled triangle, which will be half into its base will be 4 units and its height will be 16 units. So this area will be 32 square units. Now let us find out the area bounded by the parabola, the line x equal to 4 and the x-axis. Let's call it area parabola, which will be equal to integral y dx with limits on x being 0 and 4 equal to. Now what is the upper boundary? The upper boundary is given by equation of the parabola y equal to x squared. So we should replace y by x squared. 0, 4. Integral of x squared is x cubed by 3. As the lower limit is 0, the area will be 64 by 3 because cube of 4 is 64 square units. Now observe that the shaded area or the required area is area of the triangle minus the unshaded area here, which is area bounded by the parabola. Therefore, required area will be equal to area of the triangle minus area of the parabola, which equals 32 minus 64 by 3. If we take 32 common, it will be 1 minus 2 by 3. 1 minus 2 by 3 is 1 by 3. So the required area will be 32 by 3 square units. Let's go back to the question. 32 by 3 is option A. So the correct option is A. Next question. Which of the following is true? In this case, we have no other option but to check each one of them one by one. So let us start with option A. The integral of e raised to x is e raised to x. Limits are 0 and 1. So the upper limit gives us e. The lower limit gives us e raised to 0, which is 1. Is not equal to e. Therefore, A is not true. Let's go to B. Integral of 2 raised to x will be 2 raised to x upon log of 2 with limits 0 and 1. If we now substitute x as 1, we will get 2 upon log of 2 minus 2 raised to 0 1 upon log of 2. So we are getting 1 upon log of 2, which is not equal to what the option says. So B is also not true. Let's go to D now, because D is easier to find out. Integral of x is x squared by 2. Limits are 0 and 1. So this will clearly be 1 by 2, which is not equal to 1 by 3, according to the option. Therefore, the answers in A, C and D are wrong. So the correct option must be C. In the actual examination, there is no need to waste your time in finding the integral of root of x with respect to x and substituting the limits. But let's do that here. Integral of root x is x raised to 3 by 2 upon 3 by 2, limits 0 and 1, 1 raised to 3 by 2, 1, 0 raised to 3 by 2, 0, upon 3 by 2. So that indeed gives us 2 by 3, which verifies the answer. Let's go to the next question, which says, integral of sine of x minus cos of x upon 1 minus sine x into cos x dx as x goes from 0 to pi by 2 is equal to. To solve this question, we first note that the lower limit of the integral is 0. So we now check whether we can use the property integral 0 to a f of x dx equal to integral 0 to a f of a minus x dx. Let us call the given integral as I equal to 0 to pi by 2. Now wherever we have x here, we will replace it by a minus x. A is the upper limit, which in this case is pi by 2. Using the allied angles, sine of pi by 2 minus x will be cos x and cos of pi by 2 minus x will be sine x. The first term is sine x. We are replacing x by pi by 2 minus x. So here it will be cos x. Second term will be sine x upon 1 minus cos of x into sine of x dx. Let us now take this minus sign common from the numerator, which will give us minus 1 into integral 0 to pi by 2. Cos will acquire negative sign and sine will now become positive upon denominator will be as it is. Let us now write it as 1 minus sine x into cos x dx. Now the integral which I have written here is nothing but the integral in the problem. So we have got the relation I equal to minus 1 into I or 2i equal to 0, which implies that I is also equal to 0, hence option A. So to summarize this problem, it is based on this particular property of definite integrals as well as these two properties of allied angles, which are sine of pi by 2 minus theta is cos theta and cos of pi by 2 minus theta is sine theta. The other thing about this problem is that we have not used even a single integration formula here. We did not use integral of cos x dx and integral of sin x dx, nor we applied any technique of integration such as substitution, parts or partial fractions. But we made clever use of this property to conclude that the integral is equal to 0. Next, if integral 0 to 1 of tan inverse of x dx is p, then the value of the definite integral from 0 to 1 of tan inverse of 1 minus x upon 1 plus x with respect to x is pi by 4 plus p, pi by 4 minus p, 1 plus p and 1 minus p. Can the options give us any hint? Yes. We note that tan of pi by 4 is 1 or tan inverse of 1 is pi by 4. And the numbers 1 and pi by 4 are present in the options A, B and C, D respectively. Now we go to the function given in the second integral, which is tan inverse of 1 minus x upon 1 plus x. We write it as follows: tan inverse of tan pi by 4 minus tan of some angle alpha where tan alpha is x divided by 1 plus. In the integrand here, we write the x in the denominator as 1 into x. For this one, we make the replacement as tan of pi by 4. And for x, we write tan alpha as we did in the numerator equal to tan inverse of. Now recall the formula: tan of a minus tan of b upon 1 plus tan of a into tan of b is tan of a minus b. And tan inverse of tan of any angle is the same angle. So it will be pi by 4 minus alpha. But we have substituted tan alpha as x. Therefore, alpha will be tan inverse of x. So the integrand in the second integral is pi by 4 minus tan inverse of x. Now why did we do this? Look at the second term here, which is tan inverse of x. This is the same integrand which exists here in the first integral. Therefore, if we now integrate both the sides with respect to x, we will get the following relation. Limits are given in the problem 0 to 1 equal to integral pi by 4 minus tan inverse of x dx 0 to 1. So this is the integrand in the second integral, which I have written here. We have simplified it to pi by 4 minus tan inverse of x, which we have written here. And now the second integrand here corresponds to the integrand in the first integral. This one. Note that according to the problem, this integral's value is p, and you are expected to evaluate the second integral in terms of p, as all four options contain p. Therefore, the required integral will be equal to integral of pi by 4 with respect to x, which is pi by 4x, with limits 0 to 1, minus integral 0 to 1 of tan inverse of x dx, equal to. The first integral will give us pi by 4 on substitution of the limits. Second integral is p, which is given in the problem. So the required integral will be pi by 4 minus p. That is option b. So what did we learn from this particular problem? First thing is that from the options, we recognized the numbers that we were looking for, which were 1 and pi by 4. Specifically, tan of pi by 4 is 1, or tan inverse of 1 is pi by 4. Then we went to the integrand in the second integral. We tried to simplify it by using the properties of tangent and inverse tangent functions. And we successfully expressed this integrand in the second integral as pi by 4 minus integrand in the first integral. In the last part of the problem, we simply integrated pi by 4 with respect to x, which gave us pi by 4. And the second integral turned out to be p, which was given in the problem. So the required integral is pi by 4 minus